Essence of Sufism, Part 4. There is another possibility. The word Sufi can be derived from the word Sufa. It implies purity, cleanliness, and purification. That too is good. When you live a life of choicelessness, a natural purity comes. But remember, this purity has nothing of morality in it. It does not mean pure in the sense of being good. It means pure in the sense of being divine, not in the sense of being good either. Pure simply means pure of all ideas, good and bad, both. Purity implies transcendence. One has no idea at all of purity, no prejudice whatsoever. One trusts life so utterly that one need not have any idea. And when there is no idea, then one can live without ideas. As such, as we are, we live with ideas that this is good and this is how I have to live. This is bad. And when there is no idea, then one can live without ideas. When ideas are there in the mind, they create impurity. Ideas create wounds. When you are too full of ideas, you are too full of dirt. All ideas are dirty. Yes, even the idea of God is a dirty idea because ideas are dirty. For a Sufi, God is not an idea. Instead, it is his lived reality. It is not somewhere sitting on a throne high in the heavens, as is conceived by your religious preceptors. No, it is here now. It is all over the place. It is everywhere. God is just a name for the totality of existence, totality, just totality. One day a fish wanted to know where is the ocean. She read all the scriptures, tried to find from this one and that one, and could not find the answer, where is the ocean. Then one day it happened that she happened to meet a living master. The living master said, the ocean is above you, below you, on either side of you. Ocean is you, you are in ocean. Ocean surrounds you, you live in ocean. You cannot find it because you live in it. Purity means a mind without contempt, just a mechanism. Never be misguided by the word purity. It does not mean a man who has a good character. It does not mean a man who behaves according to the Ten Commandments. It does not mean a man who is respected by the society as a good man. It does not mean a man who regularly goes to the temple or the church or chants his scriptures. A Sufi has never been respected by the society. A Sufi lives such a rebellious life that the society has almost always been murdering Sufis, crucifying them. Because the Sufi makes you aware of your falsity, he becomes a constant sermon against all that is artificial. He reminds you of your ugliness. He is a reminder against your inner inhumanity to human beings, against your masks, against all that you are and represent. A Sufi becomes a constant pain in the neck to the so-called society and to the so-called respected people. I have heard it happened that once Abu Yazid, a Sufi mystic, was praying. These are just parables. In no way these have any historical semblance. It is said God spoke to Abu Yazid and said, Yazid, now you have become one of my chosen people. Should I declare it to the world? Abu Yazid laughed. He said, yes, you can. If you want me to be crucified, then declare. You declared about Al-Hilaj Mansur. You made him declare Anal-Haq. And what happened then? You crucified him. Whenever you declare that somebody has attained, he could crucify him immediately. They do not love you. The world cannot tolerate your people. So if you want me to be crucified, declare. And it is said that God never declared about Abu Yazid. He kept quiet. And this has always been so. Someone asked Al-Hilaj Mansur, the greatest mystic ever, what is the ultimate in Sufi experience? Al-Hilaj said, come tomorrow. Tomorrow you will come to know what is the ultimate in Sufi experience is. Nobody knew what was going to happen the next day. The man asked, why not today? Al-Hilaj said, we just wait. It is going to happen tomorrow. The ultimate in Sufism. And the next day, he was crucified. And when he was crucified, he shouted loudly for his friend who had asked the question. He said, where are you hiding in the crowd? Now come on and see the ultimate in Sufism. This is what it is. If you start living in God, you become intolerable to the so-called society, to your so-called family, because family is the byproduct of society. Family is a hypothetical world. Tell me if you ever come across a family. What you come across is a group of people. The sociological definition of the family is a group of people connected through a common bond. Society, family, nation, these are hypothetical words to be found only in the dictionary, and we are concerned with these words. If you want to bring about a change in family, you cannot bring about, because family does not exist. What exists is a set of individuals. If we consider individual as the unit of family or society or nation, we can bring about a transformation. An individual can be transformed, but not the family, not the nation, not the society. But this is what we are doing. We are trying to improve something which is hypothetical. And when he was crucified, he shouted loudly for his friend who had asked the question. He said, where are you hiding in the crowd? Come on and see the ultimate in Sufism. This is what it is. If you start living in God, you become intolerable to the so-called society, to your so-called family, because family is a byproduct of the society. The society lives in hypocrisy, so is the family. None can tolerate truth. Truth has to be crucified. A society, a family can love the church, but it cannot love Christ. It can love the Vatican Pope, but it cannot love Jesus. When Jesus is gone, then it is good. Then you can go on worshipping him. When Mansur is gone, you can go on talking about him. But when he is there, he is a fire. Only those who are ready to be consumed by the fire will be ready to fall in love with Mansur. Remember, both society and family are false. They exist only in your dictionaries and in mine. In reality, you never come across anything like family and society. All you see is people. A person can be transformed. He is a living phenomenon. Both are non-existent. And anything that is non-existence can never be transformed. Sufa means purity. Purity in the sense that there is no content in the mind anymore. Mind has disappeared. There is no mind, no thinking, and no thought. It is the state of samadhi, it is the state of saturi, as Zen calls it. There is another possibility, and that too is beautiful. And I accept all the possibilities. The third possibility comes from another word, Sufia. The word means chosen as a friend by God. Sufis say that you cannot search for God unless He has already chosen you. You cannot search for God unless He has already chosen you. How can you search for God? You talk as if you have already known God. You can search only for that you have already known. You can never know the unknown, and God is both unknown and unknowable. All initiative is from the side of God. He is searching for you. God desires for you. He goes on groping for you. He goes on calling, "Where are you?" When He chooses somebody, only then do you start choosing Him. You may not know, because when He chooses, how can you know? The same is true about the Master. You think that you choose a Master? This is all holy nonsense, just nonsense. It is always the Master who chooses you. The very idea that you choose the Master is egoistic. How can you choose the Master? How will you know in the first place who the Master is? How will you decide what criterias have you got? You cannot choose a Master. Instead, the Master chooses you. Master goes on choosing many who are not yet even alert about it. But they have started moving the moment the Master chooses. They think they are searching for a Master. They think they are seekers. And it is natural. It can be forgiven. But they have been chosen by somebody, and so is the ultimate case with God. Chooses you first, then you start feeling a hunger for Him, and it is only Sufis who have told this. No other tradition has said so clearly that man cannot choose God. It is God who chooses man. It is a blessing. Even to feel a thirst for God is a great blessing. You should feel happy that you have been chosen. You should be happy that God has already called you. The first call is always heard in the deep unconscious. This you cannot figure it out. You do not know what it is, from where it is coming. You feel it as if it is coming from within you. It is not coming from you. Man cannot take the initiative. How can a man take initiative? Man is so impotent. Man is so helpless. He cannot start the journey on his own unless he is pulled. Unless some magnetic force starts pulling him towards some unknown goal. You can choose only that which you know. How can you choose God? You can take the initiative for the worldly things because you know them. You can have an idea of how to purchase a beautiful house or how to have this woman as your wife or this man as your husband, or oh, how to have more money, more power, and more prestige. All such things you can choose. How can you choose God? You have not even had a glimpse, not even in your dreams. How can you choose something so utterly unknown to you? But you are not unknown to God, so He can choose you. Whenever He chooses, a great desire arises in you to find Him. That is an indication that He has chosen you. You have become a Sufi, chosen as a friend by God. That is also beautiful. The fourth possibility comes from the Greek word Sufia. Sufia means wisdom. Wisdom is not synonymous with knowledge. Knowledge is through scriptures, through others. It is borrowed. Wisdom arises in your own being. It is a light unto yourself. Wisdom means that you know, and when you know, there is no question to believe. Knowledge is belief. Somebody says God is, and you believe. You believe the man. Hence you believe whatsoever he is saying must be truth. Jesus says God is, and you believe. I say God is, and you believe. This is knowledge. You love me, you trust me, and you start believing. This is knowledge. And a man becomes a Sufi only when he has known. When he himself has known, when he himself has touched the reality, when he himself